Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's an honor and pleasure to be here with you this evening and bring you greetings on behalf of the City of Pickering. But more importantly tonight, I'm very honored to introduce the first recipient, the Honorable David C. Onley, a gentleman that I've known for a number of years now and have a great deal of personal respect for. So it really is an honor to be here tonight. The Honorable David C. Onley was appointed as Ontario's 28th Lieutenant Governor following a distinguished career as a broadcaster. In fact, served in that capacity from 2007 to 2014. His honor has championed disability issues for many years, having served as chair of the Accessibility Standards Advisory Council of the Government of Ontario, as an Accessibility Council member for the Rogers Centre and the Air Canada Centre. As Ontario's first Lieutenant Governor with a physical disability, Mr. Onley adopted accessibility as the overarching theme of his mandate. He defines accessibility as that which enables people to achieve their full potential, and believes that true accessibility occurs when disabled people can fully participate in the social, cultural, and economic life of our society. Because accessibility includes equal access to opportunities such as education, his honor expanded the Aboriginal Youth Literacy Initiative to include computer literacy programs. Mr. Onley was born in Midland, Ontario, grew up in Scarborough, and has been inducted into the Canadian Disability Hall of Fame and the Scarborough Walk of Fame. He is the recipient of the Rick Hansen Award of Excellence, the Courage to Come Back Award, and holds 11 honorary degrees. Currently, he is teaching poli-sci at the University of Toronto Scarborough campus, is the UTSC ambassador to the Pan Am and Para Pan Games, and is advisor to Minister Brad Duguid on accessibility matters. Ladies and gentlemen, when we talk about people, we have a tendency to list what they do. It really doesn't talk to what they are. Mr. Onley is a man of courage and conviction, deep faith and commitment to his community. David Onley, it's a pleasure. Thank you.
Azeem, ladies and gentlemen, Mayor Ryan, Dave, thank you very, very kindly. I just want to thank the IDI for this award. It was my pleasure to be here as Lieutenant Governor in the past. I was honored to be invited to come back and even more honored to receive this award. It's significant to me because of what the IDI stands for, which is why I was pleased to be here as Lieutenant Governor and why I was pleased on various occasions to invite members of the IDI to attend events at the Lieutenant Governor's suite of offices. In the world that we live in now, that is in such desperate need of reconciliation on so many different levels, it behooves us all to be involved in ways that materially improve and increase the opportunities for collegiality, for friendship, and for reconciliation. And because these are things that IDI has stood for 10 years, and which we all here tonight believe in, this award is especially meaningful to me. Also, as someone who at a very early age was a patient at Sick Kids Hospital, I would urge you, because they did a pretty good job, I would urge you to make those donations tonight before you leave. And again, my thanks to everyone at the Intercultural Dialogue Institute. Thank you all very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, every year thousands of Canadian students make the life-altering decision to drop out of high school. In some of the country's most vulnerable neighborhoods, more than 50% of students do not graduate high school, taking a dramatic toll on our communities, our health, our justice system, and our economy. Pathways to Education is helping youth in low-income communities graduate from high school and successful transition to post-secondary education. Pathways addresses systematic barriers to education by providing leadership, expertise, and community-based program proven to lower dropout rates. The Pathways program provides a comprehensive set of academic, financial, and social supports to youth. The results of this unique program have been groundbreaking, reducing high school dropout rates by as much as 70%, and increasing the rate at which our youth go on to college and university up to 300%. Founded in 2001, Pathways operates nationally across Canada with programs in Ontario, Quebec, Nova Scotia, to Manitoba, and British Columbia. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and help me welcome Mr. Samuel L. Dubuck, Chair of Pathways to Education, as we present him with this award tonight on behalf of Pathways. Put your hands together.
I'd like to thank the IDI for recognizing Pathways to Education with this award. It's a great honor to be up here. It's a great honor to be mentioned in the same breath as the Lieutenant Governor. Thank you very, congratulations to you as well on all the great work that you're doing. The Excellent Community Service Award truly recognizes the shared mission that we have with the IDI at Pathways. You've seen a bunch of pathways, so I won't go through my speech because I think that really tells you, but you know, our goal, our dream, the reason why we get up every morning, the 300 people that work directly in Pathways with our 8,000 kids across the country from Halifax to Vancouver, the 1,500 volunteers that get up and come and help tutor our kids and help mentor our kids, you know, the 4,500 different folks that are involved day to day across this country making Pathways a success. The reason why, Ms. Moretti, your government has been so generous to Pathways here in Ontario, and the federal government has been so generous to Pathways across the country, is because we share a common goal. Our belief, as you saw in the thing, as you saw in the video here, is it shouldn't matter where you were born, it shouldn't matter what you look like, shouldn't matter what your parents do, it shouldn't matter what you believe in, who you worship, or how you think. Everyone in this country, everyone in this great country of ours, should have the opportunity to a better life. And a better life comes through better education, it comes through better understanding, and it comes from better awareness that the differences among us make us the best. So on behalf of my colleagues at Pathways, and like I said, thousands of people across the country, and the many great governments that support, and the many thousands of volunteers and funders that support us as well. Thank you very much. We're quite honored to receive this award.
Thanks, Gary, for a help up the stairs. That's definitely other duties as assigned as the CEO of the Region of Durham, so thank you. Appreciated. Good evening, everyone. It's wonderful to see so many colleagues and friends, and it's wonderful to present this next award as the Ontario Minister of Children and Youth Services and Minister responsible for women's issues. But first, I do want to congratulate IDI for their work over the last decade. It's been incredible. And of course, this 10th anniversary is a validation of the great work being done and the progress that's been made. And I also want to give a shout out to my first involvement with IDI in Durham region, and what a thrill it's been to be part of the essay and art contest with the Durham schools, within which diverse groups of students have had an opportunity to express themselves through that process. And I know IDI is just a strong player in the region of Durham as well as in Scarborough. I represent both areas as an MPP. So I want to say thank you to IDI for making tonight happen, but more importantly for all the work you do between the events. It's very, very important. So, it is my pleasure to present the first Emerging Young Leaders Award to Mustafa Ahmed, the poet. So I don't know, Mustafa, if you want to come up while I talk about you. There he is. So So I hear he doesn't really need a big introduction, but I'm going to give him one anyway because, well, who doesn't like hearing others compliment in front of them, a big crowd, right? So I'll just take a minute to talk about your great accomplishments. Only 17 years old, 18, now 18. Mustafa is a spoken word artist, actor, and MC. From the age of 10, he's utilized words to help express his experiences and his observations. Coming from Regent Park, Mustafa has been a witness to the revitalization of his neighborhood. He utilizes the powers of the arts to speak and demonstrate his understanding of the intricacies of communities, such as touching on topics such as youth empowerment, mental health, Islam, immigration, and youth violence. Mustafa has an opportunity of performing in various venues, including CBC Metro Morning, Children's Aid Society, the Metro Convention Center, the Stand Up for Young Men's Conference, and the Mayor's Art Ball. He is a Free the Children Youth Scholar and has opened up for artists such as Janine Akeo and Pharaoh Marco. Thank you. He has had the opportunity to perform alongside Margaret Atwood and Dr. Samantha Nutt. He's also worked with Nelly Furtado, Broken Social Scene, and poet George Eliot Clark. I think I have found my next advisor to the next version of Ontario's Youth Action Plan right here. So with that, I'm very, very honored to present this year's Emerging Leader Award to Mustafa Ahmed. Thank you. Congratulations.
Good evening, everyone. I want to thank God first. I want to thank Allah. All praise is due to Allah. He's the reason I'm here today, and without Him, I am nothing. I want to thank my family. I want to thank all my friends at Table 12, my old friends, my new friends, for being so welcoming to me. I want to thank the community of Regent Park and my family for the tough love, and sometimes the love was so tough that I didn't recognize the second word in that saying, but nonetheless it was there and it existed, and it helped me grow into the person that I am today. They actually wanted me to share a poem with you guys today as I accepted the award, so I'm going to share a piece with you guys. This piece is the first piece of the three pieces that I'm writing. I'm being commissioned by the Pan American Games. I'm the official poet laureate for the Pan Am Games. And that too is a great honor. I want to thank IDI. This is such a great honor for me to be recognized. And I'm not only here representing myself and representing my family, but I'm representing the young minorities of the city. I'm representing the young youth from the inner cities. And I think the most important thing is I want to thank them for recognizing the difference and for embracing. I want to thank everyone, and I want to recognize all the people in my life who embraced my differences. And I think that where we begin to start seeing change is when we're able to embrace those differences. And we have to understand that some of the systems that are set in place, the education system, is not built for everyone to thrive. And that we need alternatives, right? We need alternatives. I grew up believing that the marks that I got in school, they determined where I was going to be in my life. And if it weren't for some people in my life who told me that the poetry that I wrote and that the art that was spilling onto the page was something so incredible, was something that I can use to carry with me my whole life, I don't know where I'd be right now. Because at some point in my life, I thought that those marks determined where I was going to be, and that a 90 was going to take me further in life, and that a 70 was going to hold me back. But I want people to know, I want all the youth in the city to know that there's so much more. It's so much bigger than your marks, and it's so much bigger than just the education system itself. That it's about that learning, it's about that knowledge, and it's not about the certificate that you get at the end of the program. So without further ado, I'm going to begin this piece. You can go sit down or like you want
to.
Oh, I'm
happy to listen.
Okay, yeah, for sure. She is going to be a part of the performance. As like you can take a look at her, you know, if my face bores you. Dear mind of mine, many fences in my way are once created by me. Dear mind of mine, even you can be a barrier depending on my level of self-belief, and I'm still learning how to believe. So how do I release myself from the grips of me? But within the grips of me, within you is my imagination. And it was not created by those who constructed limitations, so I will be free. And I let my mind grow larger than my body, grow where thought is missing to what and where I want to be. So from papers, I wrote my faith like billboards, higher and larger, fearless and taller. I want to skate on fresh lakes and recollect on mountain peaks. I'll take a walk on the beach. I need minerals to fuel my curiosity that I may find on the horizon and not below my feet. I want to run on the horizon's tightrope and let the fear of the rope possibly not existing give me the strength to soar. And even if I fall, tired and sore, I'll take hold of a sunbeam and lift myself back up, because these goals are worth fighting for. I'd rather that than stand by abandoned sandcastles and wishes by the seashore. And like many, I am a stranger to this world, constantly traveling through a true creativity vortex, twisting my realities with my visual cortex, and in my core, text that writes B. So if the present image is unbearable, I'll roll my pupils back into my insides and remind myself to be, leave, and as they roll back, I'll continue twisting my realities until my actions rain across regions. And yes, I'm still the young rose from the inner city, sprouting from the cracks of Regent, dodging the many odds, wrestling the many demons, but I learned to dream louder than the gunfire in the evenings. Yes, I learned to dream louder than the gunfire in the evenings, to dream intrepidly. Is letting these rocks fall in the sea. To dream intrepidly is letting these rocks fall in the sea. I'm contemplating my legacy. I want the ripples to spread farther than water. I'm ready to take hold of my legacy and know that these rocks only fall because I'm scratching the edge of a cliff, getting ready to dive in this sea of risk where people fight for hours, days, years. For hours, days, years. For hours, days, years. They fight. They fight for moments that may never come, doing keep-ups with the moon or racing the sun, because there can only be one. There can only be one of you, so be the greatest one you can be, because the memory of you stands as proof. So how much of you will you give to prove, to pump the blood of your truth? For memories have a life of their own. They live longer than we do. And yes, those in the sea of risk, their constant efforts made for the absence of fear. Still every part of their body filled with sweat, sweat that has seen more emotion than tears, because for hours, days, years, for hours, days, years, for hours, days, years, they have fought for this moment they could say we are here. Loud, emphatic, we are here. Thank you so much.
Seems we introducers have a common prop. It is a distinct pleasure for me to have been part of the hosting committee and to have played a role in this evening and its selection of honorees. for me personally, and of course for me on behalf of the synagogue whose president I was until my term very recently ended. It's also a very particular and unusual pleasure to introduce the son of very close friends. We've known Danny since he was a twinkle in his parents' eyes. So this is a kind of particular pleasure for me, because you can imagine this kind of thing does not happen very often. On the other hand, for Danny, it may be a cause of some anxiety for the things I might choose to say. However, I've only got 2 minutes, so he's safe. Danny is one of the four children in the remarkable Richmond family. They're community connectors, all of them, and activists in what we members of the Jewish community call tikkun olam, making this world better. Danny, rather symbolically, was born on Human Rights Day in 1985. He was an exception from his earliest days, a kid very much of his own mind. He was a smiling organizer even when our friends got together at my in-law's summer place up near Creemore, and Danny would, in a very smiling way, have the whole place organized in no time flat at the age of 3. Now, it wasn't always smooth sailing, like the time around age 17 when he simply disappeared. Now, you can imagine the anxiety this generated. No sign, no message, no calls for several days. Drugs, abducted, lost without money or ID. Nah, not Donnie. Not Danny. He used his Air Canada points. Now, I'm not quite sure where he got them, but he used them to leave the country. He went to New York to attend a human rights conference. Then there was the matter of education. He did extremely well in high school. And of course, education's the great driver and the highest cultural asset in the Richmond family. So after high school, Danny, the organizer, dabbled in university, but he went to Guyana to teach young adolescents about sex and HIV/AIDS, and then to Ghana, to an orphanage, and a bunch of other places. His parents weren't entirely pleased with this at the moment, and we friends were on occasion drawn into the discussion. But what are you going to do? Fast forward to 2006. There was a quick gathering of family and friends. The topic? Danny. Still not in school. But then again, just asked by the Governor General, Michaela Jean, to be one of two youth representatives of this country on her state visit to Africa. I'll never forget we befuddled elders offering sage advice on how he might deport himself and make the most of the opportunity. The engaging, modest Danny just took it all in, and what I've heard from many others over the years was a star of that famous Canadian the Canadian African presence raising state tour. And then he became a Blair Fellow, traveling the world to bring faiths and cultures together. Never did get that undergraduate education, but he now has a master's degree. And by the way, he more or less lets his parents know where he is. If our faiths and cultures provide the vibrance and diversity that gives energy and purpose to the human race, Danny Richmond represents our optimistic future. At a moment when those same faiths and cultures seem so mutually unknowing at times, and so incalculably violent at times, then it's to people like Danny that we turn and we're optimistic. So from that rather family perspective, I'm very excited to call on Dr. Shafiq Kadri, the MPP for Etobicoke North, and the Parliamentary Assistant to the Premier, to present Danny Richmond with the IDI Emerging Youth Leaders Award.
Thank you, Harvey. In particular, thanks for not bringing baby photos to this gathering. Distinguished guests, family, friends, chers amis, I would like to begin by thanking the Mississauga of New Credit for hosting us on their land tonight. It is with gratitude and humility that I thank the board and staff and Azeem for this honor and recognizing the important work that they do between these amazing friendship dinners. It is also an honor to be sharing the stage with Mustafa Ahmed, who, as soon as I found out that I was getting an honor alongside, I said, crap, because you never want to follow that guy. And then it is also a particular honor to be recognized alongside the amazing work of Pathways to Education and the Honorable David Onley, who has reminded us all that we have the potential to be a role model or a strong helping arm, and constantly challenges us to ensure that accessibility issues are all our issues. Speaking of sharing stages, President Gertler, if my parents should try to bribe you to get me into U of T Medical School, do what I do, which is smile and walk away. Being born into my family, as you've heard, has been a great privilege and challenge to live up to the example set by my parents, Mary and Les Richmond, my siblings, my aunts, and finally my grandparents of blessed memory. Their collective wisdom and love has always been with me on every journey. In the Jewish tradition, the question is asked, who is wise? The response is simple, one who learns from all peoples. I joined in this work of bringing cultures and faiths together because I wanted to play a part in ensuring this country doesn't simply tolerate, but rather thrives on the diversity of our communities. Director of the Pluralism Center at Harvard University, Diana Eck, tells us this distinction between just a passive acceptance of differences of our strangers amongst us to an active engagement with our neighbors is at the heart of a pluralistic nation. At this moment in history, it is particularly difficult to stay optimistic about that virtue of diversity. These past few weeks in Europe have demonstrated the high stakes involved. A mentor of mine and founder of the Interfaith Youth Corps, Eboo Patel, asked the question, will our differences be a bomb of exclusion, a divisive barrier, or a bridge to understanding and cooperation? This question is one that we are constantly exploring in our homes and families, in our communities, our nation, and globally. In the past, I have found resolution in working with people of every age, belief, and background from Turkey to Toronto, and embrace who have demonstrated the impulse to protect and embrace the stranger amongst them. People who have worked hard to find, deeply rooted in their belief systems, a call towards a more just society, and so many of those people are in the room. I wish those people dominated the news in the past few weeks. I believe the present and future will require young people who do not fear difference, but who thrive and love and embrace difference. My experience in the last few years, especially at Inspirit Foundation currently, has told me they're up for that challenge, and I'm excited about that. As a grandchild of Holocaust survivors, I inherited a faith that the world has the capacity to be repaired. This belief was emblematic for me in the idealism of Anne Frank, who at the age of 15, hiding for her life, wrote the following lines. It's difficult in times like these. Ideals, dreams, and cherished hopes rise within us only to be crushed by the grim reality. It's a wonder I haven't abandoned all my ideals. They seem so absurd and impractical. Yet I cling to them because I still believe, in spite of everything, that people are truly good at heart. Tonight, I recommit to that belief because, in the words of Ahmed, this is a belief worth fighting for. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, mesdames et messieurs, as I was very kindly introduced, my name is Dr. Shafiq Qadri. I'm the MPP for Etobicoke North and parliamentary assistant to the Honorable Kathleen Wynne. It's in that capacity that I'd like to say bonsoir, good evening, namaskar, salam alaikum, shalom alaikum, and Sasriyakal, and on behalf of my colleagues who are here in, from Parliament, the Honorable Rosa Maridi and the Honorable Tracy McCharles, as well as, of course, to recognize the many distinguished individuals, including, but not limited to, His Honor, His Excellency David C. Onley, Senator Meredith, my colleagues in the Federal House, and of course our various municipal officials as well. I think today has been extraordinary. I too would like to do an extreme shout out to Table 12, and thank you, Mustafa, for your, as you said, I like that phrase, a word artist. I think we're going to have to replay that. I think my colleagues in Parliament find ourselves slightly out of element because whenever we have the privilege of encountering the Honorable David C. Onley, it's usually in Parliament when he's about to proclaim or deproclaim a law or two that we've been spending months and months attempting to move through Parliament. I would simply like to salute once again, as has been mentioned, the extraordinary work of inclusion and diversity and harmony that the individuals of the IDI are propagating, are progressing, are sort of publicizing. I think I can say that with some authority. It was some 2 years ago that I had the privilege of being hosted by them in the extraordinary country of Turkey. And I would include, by the way, I might just do a quick shout out to you, Danny, as a University of Toronto Medical School graduate, it's not a bad gig. So I would encourage you. And you have to listen to the family at some point. But in any case, it's an extraordinary country full of history and rich culture and extraordinary baklava. And you had some of the burek tonight. Whether you're looking at kind of the ancient Turkey or Roman Turkey or Islamic Turkey or the beach Turkey or modern Turkey, it's an extraordinary land, and I would encourage you, amongst the other prompts that have been offered from this podium, including to support, of course, the Hospital for Sick Children, but also for you to visit that wonderful, wonderful country and to perhaps envelop and immerse yourself in the touch of hospitality that we've seen here and that we continue to see now a decade strong, but see the source of it. And with that, I would like to say once again thank you to our hosts for your extraordinary generosity. Some of the individuals here who are here from the Turkish community actually flew back to Turkey to be our hosts on the ground. So it was an absolutely seamless transition. So merci beaucoup, thank you, teşekkür ederim. Thank you.